Good morning, traders. My name is Christopher Vecchio, Senior Currency Strategist with DailyFX. Today is Wednesday, March 15th, 2017. Here to take you through the next 30 minutes or so as we lay some groundwork for today's FOMC rate decision due out at 2 p.m. Eastern. If I could just get a quick confirmation that audio and video are now up and running. You can see my screen, hear my voice. We will get started right away. All right, I see that we are good to go. As always, if you have any comments or questions, feel free to put them in the chat box at any point in time. If you're looking for trade-specific insight, please include your entry stop and time frame. That way I know where you've gotten into the market, where your risk lies, and of course, what your point of view is. Beyond that, please be aware that any opinion I disseminate is mine and mine alone and does not constitute trade advice on behalf of DailyFX or IG Group, so please don't treat it as such. With that said, we are looking to a more interesting economic calendar today than we've had the last few days. Typically on its own, the US CPI report and advanced retail sales both would garner a significant amount of attention. However, they're really coming against a more substantial backdrop that is the March FOMC meeting. Now, when we take a look at the March FOMC meeting, it is one of the four per year in which the Federal Reserve will release new summary of economic projections, these SEPs. We'll get a new dot plot, which is the glide path of expected rate moves. And then we'll finally also get today, for the first time, this new fan chart, a fan chart that the Federal Reserve is putting out for the first time in order to help more or better graphically illustrate their point of view as to how the economy will evolve. CPI and retail sales, I don't think, are going to do much to shake the FOMC off of its current course. They've been meeting yesterday since 10 a.m. Eastern Time. I think when you look to rate expectations markets, they are fairly set in stone right now. In fact, for today's meeting, there is a 96% chance of one rate hike and a 4% chance of two rate hikes being priced in by Fed Funds futures contracts right now. But as things stand, it looks like market expectations are starting to creep forward for additional moves later on this year. When we look to June, actually, right now there is a 59.8% chance of another rate hike come June. When we look to September, the odds are well north of the 60% threshold that we like to watch. Just pulling these up here quickly. 81.6% chance expected for a rate move, the second rate hike this year come September. And for December, there's now, let's just pull here. There's now a 60.8% chance of a third rate hike by December. Now, I like to watch the December rate hike odds for that third hike in particular, and I'm looking for them to eclipse that 60% level around today's FOMC meeting, hold above there, as that's pretty much the key threshold that the market's indicated over the last 21 years for whether or not the Fed's going to hike rates. If you go back over 21 years, the Fed has never hiked rates unless the odds of a rate hike were up around 60%. Whereas if you look to, say, 50%, there have been a few false starts where the market pricing was like 55% and the Fed ended up not doing anything. But every time it's been above 60% for a given month, that's when the Fed's gone ahead and hiked rates. So we could say that the market's flirting with this idea that there are going to be three rate hikes this year. Certainly, when we look to the last time we got summary of economic projections from the Federal Reserve, that was in December. And back then we saw that we were looking for up to three rate hikes this year. So today, will a Fed rate hike right off the bat, will that make the dollar rally? And I see that question in here, and I'm going to say no. I think the market has this priced in. As far as a foregone conclusion that a rate hike could be, today is already built into the market. Okay, I'm inclined to think that the reason why the dollar hasn't rallied, and this is feeding into another question here, how come the dollar's not up after Friday's non-farm payrolls report? I'm inclined to think that there are some other factors into play here that are influencing the greenback. For starters, I think that the scope of Fed tightening is very much contingent upon the the fiscal outlook, and that's something that we should be looking for today when Janet Yellen, the Fed chair, takes the podium shortly after the Fed releases their summary of economic projections and the rate decision. That's going to be at 2:30 Eastern. She speaks to the press. Instead, when we think about what's going on with the dollar, what's been driving the U.S. dollar forward, it's been this reflation trade. Some people are calling it the Trump reflation trade. Certainly, I have before. I actually think it may be more appropriate to call it the Paul Ryan, Mitch McConnell reflation trade, because they're the ones who are pushing for some of the tax reform measures more so than Donald Trump is. In either case, this Republican reflation trade driving the greenback higher has been contingent upon this idea that we're going to see tax reform, tax cuts for businesses and consumers, as well as this infrastructure spending plan come into play at some point over the next year. Now, why does that matter? Why do we care about this? Well, the feedback loop between fiscal stimulus and tighter monetary policy is fairly straightforward. The combination of reduced taxes and increased government spending will lead to higher deficits. And more deficits, an increase in deficits over time, tend to push up inflationary pressures. And with inflation already at or above the Fed's 2% medium-term target, any policy that pushes up inflationary pressures even more will necessitate a faster pace of rate tightening. Even today's CPI report that's due out, we're expected to see 2.7% on that headline figure from 2.5% previously, the core due at 2.2% from 2.3%. So this actually draws out a very important point for us to pay attention to. If headline inflation is increasing while core inflation, which is removed food and energy, is abating slightly, where would this differential come from? Well, then necessarily the food and energy inputs. What do we know about energy prices? Well, if we look to oil markets over the last year, even though oil's been battered recently, we can see that relative to this time last year, let's say we go to, oh, March 15th, 2016, oil closed at 36.72 that day, and we're trading at 48.65. Oil's still up about 32.4% here from this time last year, so that's definitely a tailwind for consumers. Gasoline prices are higher for consumers. And so we're expecting to see inflation pick up today, but this is already in line with the Fed thinking that inflation is moving along there towards their target or has already achieved their target. They look at three measures. They look at headline, core, and PCE. Headline is 2.5% currently, expected to go to 2.7. Core 2.3, expected to go to 2.2. And PCE, the personal consumption expenditure, that's around 1.9% right now. So in essence, on one side of the Fed's mandate, the inflation side, it's being met. On the other, the full employment mandate, whether or not the U3 unemployment rate is at or below 5%, has certainly been met as well. We saw on Friday that the U3 unemployment rate ticked down to 4.7%. Now you could say, well, that's not really a true gauge of employment, Chris. You know, the labor force participation rate is so much lower now than it used to be. And I would agree with you. I think that's part of the reason why wage growth has lagged in this economy, because we've seen, or rather, despite the fact that we've seen the unemployment rate tick down to around, you know, 5% or lower for several months here, because of this overhang of labor market supply, where there are just so many market participants that are not in the labor force anymore. The second that jobs come into the picture and that wages start to go up, you have new entrants return, and as a result, it keeps wage pressures low because there's an ample supply of labor. But the Fed is going to look to the fact today that their inflation mandate is being met, their unemployment mandate, or their full employment, rather, is being met. I think we're definitely going to get a rate hike. I think that's been as clear as day now after the slew of Fed speakers we had 2 weeks ago, plus the data that we've seen over the last week. Of course, if we don't get a rate move, that would be incredibly destabilizing for the greenback, in which case the greenback would suffer considerably, and dollar-denominated assets like gold would probably do very well. Same thing for U.S. oil. But instead, again, today we're looking forward to the pace of future rate hikes. How will that unfold? The Fed said we could get up to three this year. Two to three were the outline when we saw it back in December. It's important to note that of the dots that were laid out, the non-voting members this year were among the more hawkish ones. So if we see that the Fed's glide path starts to shift forward, where people are saying, okay, yes, we're expecting three rate hikes this year, but also maybe we're due for tighter policy next year as well. The market's not pricing in enough hikes through the end of 2018. If we see those forecasts lifted, that could provide a lift for the US dollar. I think the Fed's going to be fairly confident, especially on an individual member basis, raising expectations for further hikes. When we think about what is going on down the line, we filter in this expectation of, say, fiscal stimulus. That's something that ne wasn't necessarily built into their equations previously. And so I think the fact that it does look like we're going to get some semblance of tax reform, some semblance of infrastructure spending within the next, say, 12 to 18 months, the Fed is going to want to head off rising inflation expectations. Now, again, why might have the dollar been suffering then if a rate hike set in stone and we just had this strong NFP report? I think overall, until the timeline for fiscal reform becomes clearer, then the FOMC's actions today may ultimately have little long-term sway over the dollar. Certainly, the uncoordinated rollout of the Affordable Care Act replacement, the AHCA, which, given the Affordable Care Act or Obamacare's disdain for Republicans over the last 8 years, should have been a pretty straightforward process. And in fact, back in 2015, a bill to repeal and replace Obamacare passed through the House and the Senate until it was vetoed by President Obama himself. One would think that this process would be a little bit more straightforward. Why? Well, the GOP controls the House, the Senate, and the White House now. So the fact that this rollout is taking so much time and is facing so much opposition within their own party, I think this serves as a poor litmus test for more ideologically controversial legislation regarding fiscal stimulus that have yet to come. This is supposed to be the easiest thing that they get done. Repeal and replace it. End of story. Yet now that constituents' concerns are coming into play, it appears that the path forward isn't going to be so easy. And this is going to create some tensions in between the Republican Party and itself for these other measures that need to be passed that necessarily aren't so uniformly in agreement among the caucus. Fiscal stimulus, in effect, is something that President Trump wants, but fiscal stimulus government spending isn't necessarily something that, say, House majority or Republican majority leaders want in the Senate. And so that's going to take a fair greater deal of negotiating and hand-wringing in order to bring the market to the point where it can accept that fiscal stimulus is actually coming down the pipeline. So we'll see how much the Fed pre-commits to this notion that rates are going to raise considerably because of changes in government policy. I would think that they're going to speak fairly confident about such actions coming into play, but we'll look to their growth and inflation forecasts for confirmation that such views will actually materialize. Of course, when we look at some of these markets here right now, I think Eurodollar is in a fairly interesting position considering that from February 19th to about the 10th of March, you had about 2 weeks in here of price action where Eurodollar was constrained within a fairly clear range. Okay, about 106.33 down to about 104.92, and yet our the NFP report the other day, we saw prices break out and run higher. Now, I'm also inclined to think that beyond the FOMC decision today, Eurodollar is being moved around by expectations for the French election. Looking at the odds checker, which is a website that aggregates betting odds across Europe, seeing where bets have been placed recently, we can see that market participants are pricing in about a 56% chance of Emmanuel Macron winning the French election. And this is a two-round election, mind you. There's the first round on April 23rd, in which a handful of candidates, I think roughly nine now, if I recall correctly, given the recent dropouts, if there's nine candidates, will go to the polls and they'll see whether or not they can garner enough support to make it into the second round. So the way French elections work is if a candidate cannot achieve 50% of the vote in the first round, it goes to a second round runoff between the top two competitors. Right now, Emmanuel Macron and Marine Le Pen are running back to back, neck to neck, in the first round, roughly around 25 or 26%, respectively. They're not garnering enough support individually to close the election off after one round. So then they'll go into the second round runoff on May 7th. And right now, second round polling shows that voters would take Macron ahead of Le Pen about, we'll call it 60 to 40. 60% are for Macron, 40% of Le Pen. And I think when we saw these polls come out on Friday showing that Macron's lead was expanding, it started to reduce some of this, risk premium that was being built into the euro, that was weighing on the euro, that this idea that there could be a French exit from the eurozone at some point in the next year or two, which I think is actually a foregone conclusion. It's not a guarantee by any semblance, even if Le Pen becomes the president. France has a parliamentary system of representation. The parliamentary elections are June 11th through the 17th, I believe. Okay. National Front, Le Pen's party, is polling for about 50 to 70 seats in a French parliament that has about 577 seats total, which means that the prime minister wouldn't come from her party either. In order to get a referendum brought to the public, the prime minister needs to propose it. But if he or she does not, which would be the case if National Front does not get the prime ministership, which seems very likely, then 20% of the parliamentary electorate would need to bring forth legislation to allow it to become such. And you know what? If they have 70 seats, that's only about 13% of the electorate. So I don't see a very straightforward path here. And even if Le Pen, for some set of circumstances, is able to win the presidency and the National Front is able to garner enough support to bring forward a euro referendum, let's keep in mind the fact that 75% of the French people themselves like the EU. The EU, in and of itself, was set up as a construct to prevent Germany from attacking France, basically. You go back to the European and Coal and Steel Community, the ECSC, founded shortly after the Treaty of Rome, whose 60-year anniversary is actually coming up on March 25th. We're looking at a situation where France has been, by and large, the beneficiary of no wars in Europe after World War I and World War II, where their economy and population were just completely decimated. To the French, the EU is an important institution that constitutes, the great peace that has transpired across Europe over the last 70 plus years. In fact, if you go back before World War I, or actually, let's say before the Treaty of Rome is signed, there really wasn't a period of peace in Europe that lasted more than 50 or 60 years. Before World War I, you go back and you have the Napoleonic Wars, right? And then before that, you have the French Revolution. And, I can go down the timeline here and give people a history lesson, but that's not what we're here for. In any case, the EU is an important institution to the French. I don't think they would even vote to leave the EU, provided that they had the choice to do so. And Le Pen said that she would step away from presidency if she couldn't get the country to leave the EU. So is she that much of a threat? I don't think so. I think markets, from the outside perspective, because of what we saw from Brexit, because of what we saw from Donald Trump, I think people have ramped up expectations that this populism is more popular than it is in actuality in these individual countries. Holland is voting today in elections, and it doesn't look like that Geert Wilders, the Donald Trump of the Netherlands, is going to be able to win based on recent polling figures. I see frequently people tell me, well, the polls were wrong for Brexit and Trump. I don't know what polls you were looking at, but they weren't wrong from the ones I was looking at. I could, pull them up here. Lee was ahead by 1.5% the day of the vote in our aggregate compilation in the preview that we reported on the day before the Brexit vote. When you look at the voting totals for the United States, it had Hillary Clinton beating Donald Trump by anywhere between 1 and 4 percentage points. And you know what? She won the popular vote by 2.3 percentage points. Those national polls for the U.S. presidential election were based on the popular vote. They weren't polls for the Electoral College, which is how the United States decides its presidency. And in fact, if you look at the Electoral College polls, they showed it pretty much being a toss-up. Nate Silver at 538 had a scenario where his most likely outcome was Clinton winning the popular vote, but Trump winning the Electoral College. So, you can cherry-pick examples where you have some, obviously joke expectations where 99% chance of Clinton winning. Those are purely based on people's discretionary expectations. But in terms of actual polls, not these, nonsensical models, the polls were right for Brexit. They were right for the U.S. presidential election, and I think they're going to be right for the Dutch elections today, and thus far for the French elections going forward. And I think for the euro, that's why we saw this price action outside of the consolidation region, which is why the recent price action in the last 2 days is all that more concerning, having walked a country mile to get to this point. We see here that we've broken back down into this range. Typically, when you see breakouts of such a nature, the reversal back into the consolidation means that you're going to see a complete reversal within the consolidation itself. One thing that comes to mind of recent would be what happened with Kiwi dollar. Kiwi dollar here had traded up into this resistance zone marked by the key reversal on December 14th, the FOMC rate decision day, mind you. We see here the price traded up into it, and once we got above said region, we started to challenge the downtrend of this channel that had been into play. Around that RBNZ meeting in February, price not only breaks back down below the trend line guiding price higher from beginning of the year, but we get back within this channel consolidation. And once we get back within the channel consolidation, price immediately starts to collapse. All right. Pound dollar recently. I know I'm cherry picking examples here to support my point, but I'm going to continue to do so. Pound dollar recently. We had this triangle forming here. It looked like that we made a break to the top side. We get outside the triangle, we start running higher. We can't clear out the swing high in the triangle. We eventually return into it, and then price collapses soon after. So this is just a tenet of technical analysis, right? When you see a range break and then price return into it, typically it means that not only is it a false breakup, but price is going to reverse harder within said range. So today, if we're going to see more weakness in euro dollar, if we see the Fed come out and highlight a more hawkish point of view than what we've been previously expecting, price could come down towards that mid 105 area. A trend line off the recent lows from March 2nd and then again on March 9th. Dollar yen to me is fairly interesting as well. Considering that this guy's meandering around here up near the 114.95 area, I would love to see price close through 114.95 before a long is taken. In fact, if you head on over to the Daily FX website right now on the front page, analyst pick, I outline this trade with specific details, in particular, looking for an entry on that 114.95 close, adding above 115.62. Targeting 118.66. The 13 EMA is a desired stop loss, in my opinion, and let's put this on here, not the 21. Okay. We've had TESA, but no closes below that 13 EMA since March 1st. All right. I think that provided the opportunity to get long in these two swing levels, if we break through them, because it was a nice shot at a run at the yearly high and the swing high we had in December. But more importantly, that carries us up to the descending trend line that we had from June 2015, August 2015, and then again November through early December 2015 here. Right. The trigger for me, though, is going to be what happens with the Nikkei 225, which has struggled up here a little bit recently, but we have this beautiful ascending triangle that's been in play. When we take dollar yen and measure it against the Nikkei 225, you could see how these two more or less move in lockstep. And we're going all the way back to 2009 here now, 2010. So although they've decoupled a little bit here recently, I would think that should the Nikkei 225 start to break out higher, dollar yen will be inclined to follow. R.R. Morin saying, Chris, I'm French and I have to say, Le Pen is not the Frexit candidate. Asselineau is from the UPR. He's the one who can create the surprise. I'm going to keep an eye on that. I really appreciate that heads up there. Mike's asking here, so walk us through the dot plot. At what point do we think that the market is going to react to the pace of Fed tightening? Is it going to be when the dot plot's released, or is it going to be later on? So basically, later on would be the Fed press conference. I think that there will be an initial dollar reaction once the dots are released at 2 o'clock, because that's going to outline basically the implied expectations for rates going forward, right? The dot plots reflect the aggregate assumption of all the FOMC members that are present at the meeting. And so before Janet even Yellen even comes out and speaks at the press conference, we're going to know collectively what the Fed thinks and feels. Before the Fed said that there could be 2 to 3 rate hikes basically for 2017, the markets are pricing in roughly 3 rate hikes right now. If the Fed goes ahead and raises expectations that we could see another rate hike in, say, June, that would be faster than what markets are anticipating right now. The second rate hike is scheduled to come in September, and the third in December. There's a technicality here. I see that July is pricing above 60%, but you know what? The Fed, like the ECB, like the BOE, like the RBNZ, and so many of these other central banks, they've shown the proclivity to only move on rates and change policy when they have new summary of economic projections, staff economic projections, whatever you want to call them, new growth and inflation forecasts in hand. And when the head of their central bank can come out and speak at a press conference to the market. It's a relic of the global financial crisis, but this hand-holding, if you will, is to prevent markets from overreacting to any given change in policy, any perception there. From your point of view, just think about this. If the Fed were to come out and change rates but not alter their growth or inflation forecast, you would say, okay, why would they do so if they see the economy evolving in a similar fashion? Implicitly, higher rates means that borrowing costs are going to go up, which are going to weigh on growth. So if the Fed comes out and says, we're actually going to raise rates, and they don't change their growth forecast, it might make people think that they're concerned about, say, financial stability, that there's excess liquidity in the system and it's leading to bubbles. And so along those lines, the market could sell off thereafter. The Fed doesn't want to do that. They want to show the market that the reason they're raising rates is because they have significant degree of confidence in the U.S. economy, that they feel that upcoming policy changes elsewhere will necessitate higher interest rates from them, such as a fiscal stimulus program. As a result, I don't see the Fed raising rates on one of these off meetings like May or July or October or November. Excuse me, it's not October, it's November. So the meetings this year are March 15th, May 3rd, June 14th, July 26th, September 30th, November 1st, December 30 for 13th, excuse me. If the Fed's going to move, I think it's going to be today. I think it could be in June or September, and then again in December. But I don't think we're going to see meetings in the off calendar months like May, July, or November. Just my two cents, based on what we've seen previously. And that would fit in with this pattern of behavior overall, again, of in an effort to be transparent, these central banks have become predictable. CME and Fed funds are on Bloomberg are calculated slightly differently. So the ones that I'm looking at on Bloomberg tend to be a little bit more hawkish given how they're compiled, but I'm going to put this link in here. CME Group is calling for a 90.8% chance of a rate hike come today. It's down a little bit from 93% yesterday. These are delayed about 15 minutes. Okay. I would keep an eye on these overall. There's also a copy of the Fed's dot plot in there. When you look at this chart, and I'm actually going to pull this up over to here. Okay, I sent this link over in the chat box so you can follow it in real time today. Once markets open, this will update. This was updated last night, obviously late. Most recently, when we take a look at the dot plot here, the blue dots represent the median expectation for rates over the next several years. You can kind of envision a curve, if you will, turning up here. So we're going to look to see if the median rate for 2017 bumps higher to say over 1.5%. We'll see if 2018 moves higher than roughly 1.875%. If 2019 moves higher than say 2.675%. Okay. I think this is a good resource to hold on to for today. And you can see here for December, they don't aggregate probabilities across, which I think is a little bit unfortunate. But you can see here that if today is going to go up from to 75 to 100 basis point range, right, then that means the market is currently pricing in the highest aggregate probability for December would be 125 to 150. You know, that means that ultimately we're going to have to see another rate hike before that, which means that CME Group is even saying that we're due for rate hikes three times this year. Something to keep an eye on today, U.S. yields. Short-term U.S. yields are continuing to go up. And this actually may be another reason why the dollar is not going up. Typically, short-term U.S. yield rising is good for the greenback, but you know, something to consider. Something big happens today. In October 2015, the U.S. government decided to suspend the debt ceiling. Happy anniversary. Today is the day when the suspension of the debt ceiling ends. We're seeing in T-bill markets, which are short-term U.S. government funding instruments, yields are rising. In the past, we've seen that there have been fiscal compromises in order to lift the cap. Those are fiscal compromises between a Democratic president and a Republican Congress. Now that Republicans control everything, you'd think that they don't want to be the ones to drive the economy off the edge and throw the government into a shutdown, but who knows? I don't think there's a very clear path to how this will play out going forward. The Treasury can take a number of steps today and over the next few weeks to extend the ability to function underneath the debt limit. But the spending authorization will be increasingly important as we reach that level within the next month. Tomorrow, President Trump and the administration are expected to unveil their fiscal year 2018 budget. Overall, to me, this is a situation that should be watched very carefully, as in the past, we've seen that playing chicken with the debt limit and the debt ceiling have ultimately led to steep declines in U.S. equity markets, and we've seen the dollar get hit pretty hard. Now, if you've been with me at any point over the last few weeks, you know I've been talking about this idea that the U.S. economy could get downgraded at some point in the next year or so, and I very much want to stick to that point of view. Because what we saw in August 2011, while the Standard & Poor's Group downgraded the U.S. from the AAA rating, Fitch and Moody's did not. But Fitch and Moody's warned specifically, if the U.S. government does not get a control of its budget and deficit situation where it is cutting its deficit so it stops adding to the federal debt level, and it does not implement sustainable measures to turn around its debt, then the United States could lose its AAA rating. For the last several years, we've seen that the U.S. budget deficit has fallen. In fact, I think it's under $200 billion per month right now. Now, part of that's natural. As an economy improves, deficit's going to fall because as growth goes up, then people are going to spend more money and there will be more tax remittances. So even if policy that goes unchanged between taxes going to the government going up naturally as a result of expanded economic activity, one, and two, unemployment benefits going down because more people have jobs, the deficit should fall or narrow. The fact of the matter is, right now, we're looking at President Trump who wants to greatly increase the deficit. As we talked about earlier, if we cut taxes and we implement an infrastructure spending plan, government spending is going to go up, tax remittances will go down, deficit will expand again. So, between the fact that we are looking at expanding deficits later on this year, which are pretty much the backbone for the Fed raising rates, and then we also have this idea that we're running into this debt ceiling and the suspension of the debt ceiling is running out today, I'm very much inclined to think that we could be looking at another downgrade at some point. So, despite everything that the Fed's doing today, I think that's also a pretty important story that's just unfolding. I think you should be watching out for it. And, for something like dollar yen, we're seeing that U.S. yields have gone up, but dollar yen has decoupled from these U.S. yields, right? Purple line being dollar yen, blue line being U.S. yields. They were traveling together right after the election. They started to separate themselves now. One has to be concerned about what's going on with the fiscal equation. Yes, Michael, the dot plot is suggesting that medium-term rates for 2017 is just a hair over 1.25%, which means they're expecting the range to be between 1.25 and 1.5. Technically, the Fed puts out its policy based in a range for the median rate. And so that would say, considering we're currently in the 50 to 75 point range, if we're going to go to 75 and 100 today, we do a second rate hike in, say, June or September, do we go to 100, 125? A third rate hike would bring us to 125 to 150, which carries us into the Fed's medium term expectation for 2017. Good question here. If there's going to be greater risk to the dollar, does that mean gold would rally? I'm inclined to think so. If we were to take off the yield and dollar yen charts, and we put up an inverse of gold. You can see here how gold and the yen have previously traveled together, particularly from last year. That's gold and yield, excuse me. Gold and the yen. Yeah, starting last beginning of last year, once the BOJ cut their rates into negative territory. Interest rate differential between the cost of carrying gold, which is about 2.4% per year, and yen itself, negative 0.1%, started to shrink. Closest yielding currency, they start to behave more and more alike. This year, we've seen that dollar yen has thus far outpaced gold. Insofar as given where dollar yen is and price action previously, one would expect that gold would actually be a little bit weaker. Again, I think that there's some political risk premium built into gold because of what's going on in Europe. What's going on maybe with US debt? When you look at yields and gold, you can see here how higher yields for part of the end of last year and beginning of this led to weaker gold prices. This is not gold alone, this is one divided by gold. So this is the inverse of gold price, okay? As the bar chart there, the blue line is US yield, 2-year yield. And again, we start to separate ourselves here. Gold starts to outperform its implied value based on US yield as well. So I'm inclined to think that despite we've seen higher yields, gold is kind of sticking through it. I mean, recently, you can say that the bounce in yields has negatively impacted gold, and I would agree with you there. But drawing it out on a longer term basis, gold is not nearly as weak as it otherwise could be, given what the yield situation is. Someone's asking, what are the tickers for yields in TradingView? US02Y and US10Y will give you the 10-year yield. You can see here how gold and the 10-year yield recently are matching up in terms of cadence after separating themselves for part of January and February. All right. With that said, we've been running for about 45 minutes here. A little bit longer than anticipated, but nevertheless, good conversation today. Again, the FOMC rate decision is due up today at 2 p.m. Eastern. That's 14 Eastern or 18 GMT. My colleague, John Kickletter, will be covering that live. You can always register for that webinar here. He's our chief strategist, so always will be a good conversation. I certainly tune in for those events. Put the link in the chat box there. Of course, if you have any other comments or questions, you're more than welcome to reach out to me today. You can always do so through the DailyFX real-time news feed, Stock, Twits, and Twitter at CVecchioFX. You can always get to the real-time news feed by going up to the news banner in the ribbon there, clicking on real-time news. You can always email me, CVecchio@DailyFX.com. Tomorrow morning, we're going to be reviewing what happened in today's FOMC webinar, or FOMC meeting, with a webinar called the Central Bank Weekly. We'll also be talking about the BOE, the BOJ, the SMB, several central banks meeting this week. I'll put this in the chat box as well. Beyond that, good luck trading the rest of today. Keep an eye on the calendar in about 45 minutes when we have US CPI and retail sales coming up. That's certainly going to try to move the market. Other than that, talk to everyone soon.